Well, since the championship, of course, it's hardly been sweetness and light, really. Amazing that you haven't won an away game since the day the title was won back in April 1992. Do you think that's just an adverse reaction to success?
We surprised a lot of people in winning it. I'm not so sure we didn't surprise one or two of ourselves. I'm not so sure now, looking back, that maybe some of my lot thought us win a championship, not probable. Us win a championship, cool, we've done it. And then us win a championship again. You know, that would be a dream. I think that came into it. I think we had injuries. I think the European thing took on too big a phenomenon in people's minds. All sorts of reasons. We didn't play well, we made mistakes. There was a change in the back pass rule. I think that affected us. I think people were less consistent the season afterwards. So there's a whole range of factors. We had a lot more injuries, which meant we weren't going to be as good as we were the season before. Perhaps not least of which would be the fact that maybe we couldn't have been as good as we were the year before, because maybe the year before we got just about as much out as everybody as it was possible to get. Sometimes that's a problem with achievement. If you overachieve, the only thing after that's disappointment.
Howard's circumstances have decreed that our talk today should take place at the Belfry, where the Ryder Cup will be staged later this month. Do you look at other sports, for example, in management, as well as looking at other football managers?
I think it's just a natural extension of your job. The best performers in all other areas are of interest to you, but in particular, the best performers in sport. And in that, there are certain aspects of the golf game and certain aspects of the good golfers, which you'd be a fool to ignore if you were aware of them.
Did you use, I believe, a golfing analogy as part of your pep talks as the championship came looming into sight?
Yeah, well, as you know, it's recently become an obsession of mine in the last 18 months. I just tried to make them less pressured in the situation. I tried to get them to go out and to perform to their maximum, and I used the analogy of, Open Championship, you've done all the hard work, it's the last round. You are three strokes ahead, or you are tying for the lead, whatever the situation, because it changed during those last few weeks. Trust your swing, don't go doing things different, trying to do things better. Go out and play the normal golf round that you play. If you shoot 67 and win, that's terrific. If you shoot 68 and don't win, that's not a disaster. Probably just means that you got unlucky.
The clubs that you've been involved with as coach and manager have played a variety of styles, but what's your basic belief about the way the game should be played?
I could indulge myself easily, and I could get the team to play in the way that I liked it to play, and play in a way which I like to coach. But that team might not get the results that it either wanted, deserved, or needed. Now, my responsibility, whether I'm coach or manager, whichever way you want to do it, my responsibility is to get that team to get the results it can get. And I've got to take a lot of things into account. If I indulge myself, if I indulge my whim and finish up fourth, not promoted, that's all right if the directors have said that's what they want, and that's all right if the fans are prepared to put up with that. And we can finish fourth the next year, until such times as I can get some players who can play that way better. But if, there are some pragmatists around who say, look, we can get what you want a lot quicker if you get us into a higher flight where we'll have more money and so on and so forth. then I've got a responsibility to the football club, first and foremost.
Apart from your current responsibilities at Leeds United, you're also chairman of the recently formed League Managers Association. Tell us about that.
We've got a lot to offer, but in the past we've destroyed ourselves, or we've destroyed what we've got to offer through destroying ourselves, arguing amongst each other and so on and so forth. Because really, we've never sorted out what the important issues were and dealt with them. I think now, what we've got now is we've got people involved who recognise what the issues are and are prepared to make sacrifices from their own point of view. I think the powers that be recognise that we're not raving lunatics who dash from here to there on a whim. They recognise we do have a cohesive, rational point of view. They recognise we do love football. It's our passionate hobby. That's why we're in it, mostly. You know, and that passion and that love of it, added to our experience, means I think that a lot of the times we have a very, very significant contribution to make to the decision-making process in terms of the game in general. Unfortunately, up until fairly recently, we've not shown ourselves to be that way. That point of view, I think, is changing. I think the game can only benefit from it.
Turning to England now, the national team are just about to take on Poland in the crucial World Cup qualifier. You have been very critical of the system under which Graham Taylor has to operate.
Oh, the England manager's job in this country is an impossible job. It's absolutely impossible. He's got to fight the system. It seems he's got to fight the press. Or a lot of the press from day one. We seem to have a totally unrealistic perception of what we are supposed to achieve. I mean, I remember when Bob was in Italy, and I worked with Bob, I worked with Ron, and I saw the pressure that they came under. I was with them at times during World Cups and European Championships. I remember once in Italy, I think after we played Ireland, I think it was the Sun ran a headline, disgrace, bring them home or something. And 10 days or 2.5 weeks later, when we were in the semi-final and had gallantly lost to, you know, it was bring them home, knight them all, make them freedom, give them the freedom of Great Britain. You know, and let's face it, these people do influence public opinion.
But when you go into management, that is surely the job at the top of the tree.
Yeah, when you go into politics, the Prime Minister's the job at the top of the tree, isn't there? But there aren't too many people in the Labour government at the moment think they've got a chance of getting it.
Do you think you've got a chance of getting it if it becomes available?
Oh, I've only just started to develop and understand my directors at Leeds, and I'm glad I have, because they're a great set of blokes. As to understanding the minds of those who operate inside Lancaster Gate, you know, all I'd be doing would be guessing.
But if you were asked?
If I were asked, I'd have to consider it, and I'd hope that my sensible self would say no, because I've got enough problems at the moment. You know, if I could, I'd like to help Graham, but I can't.
On a personal note, you're enjoying your second family now. Do you feel, as you've grown older, that your priorities have become clearer?
I have done a lot. I have been non-league, I have worked for the FA, I've worked in the league, I've worked in the Premier League. I've been a bricklayer's labourer, a plasterer's labourer. I've worked on the bread vans, I've painted, I've driven taxis, I've done a lot. And it's only comparatively recently that my football life, as it were, has become perhaps more comfortable. In the early days, without a question of a doubt, it was at the expense of my family. It was at the expense of my two oldest kids, Anna and Damien. They suffered. And in them suffering, I didn't get to enjoy the sort of relationship a parent should have with his children and kids. That and other factors, you know, I was determined that this time that wouldn't happen. Nobody's given more to football than I have. But at times I've given it at the expense of others. And that's not right. That's not right. And sometimes the price I've paid has been too great even for me, although it's my choice. And that's not right. So I try, and it's not possible. You do it with great difficulty. I try now to make sure that at least the proportion in terms of importance, I certainly now I'm very, very clear as to where my priorities lie.
Does that mean the family takes greater priority in terms of importance, if not in time, to football?
Yeah, obviously in terms of time, that's absolutely. You've got no chance. This job is an 18-hour-a-day job, mostly 7 days a week for most of the year, without a shadow of doubt. But at the end of the day, we are talking about a job. We are talking about a sport. We are not talking about people's lives. So, yeah, it is very serious, and life or death, and more serious than that. We all know the old Shankly cliches. But at the end of the day, we know they're not true. We know they're not true. Other people's well-being in the long term is much more important at the end of the day than anything you can give that might just make that little bit extra in the job. Although they still have to make sacrifices, but if you're doing well, the rewards are great. And it is the best way of earning a living. The second best way, the first best is playing. Whatever it is playing. The second best is managing, without a shadow of a doubt. So every day that's happening, you've got to be well pleased. That's not a bad start. If you wake up and then you know you're going into a job like that, that's not a bad start.
Howard, finally, you are a member of an elite group of present-day managers, just five, who have won the league championship. You'll be 50 in a couple of months' time, although I must say you look very well on it. But are you reaching a point now where you address the future and have plans now that you want to share with us for the rest of your working life?
The future is staying in work. And to stay in work, you've got to be successful. I keep telling my wife that I'm going to retire at 55. She doesn't believe me. I've got books and videos and things I want to do, you know, that would keep me occupied for the next 30 years. She maintains that after a fortnight, I'd be bored out of my head. Who knows? I think one thing I've learned is that, you know, going back to Jimmy, you can only deal with what you can deal with, and mostly in football, that's the next game and the next week. And I've come a long way since Boston United, when, as a matter of interest, Kettering weren't the best team in the country in non-league because they won the Southern League Premier, we won the Northern Premier League, and when we had the playoff for the Champion of Champions, we beat them home and away, and we beat them in the FA Cup the week after.
You mentioned that to Ron.
He never did have a good memory for defeats.
Howard, thanks for your time today.
Thank you very much. Thank you.